Well, we get a chance today to talk some MMA as a local fighter was in action on the UFC card. We'll also talk some boxing. A big card is announced and a lot more on the way as we get to some summertime sports, including a little fishing. Yeah, we'll get to it all right here on the sports news that is powered by the Red Zone over on Regent Street, Conant Automotive in Stoughton as well. Your headlines next here on the sports news on 57 Sports. All right, time now for the headlines. Your look into the tackles, hits, checks, and dunks that make up the local sports scene. I am Rich Reynolds, and as always, let's hit the ground running. You know, here at 57 Sports, we have been able to bring you the last three chosen few cards in their entirety. On our last broadcast, we were joined by a local fighter, Gerald Mearshart, who competes at the sport's highest level, and that is the Ultimate Fighting Championship. On Saturday night in Vegas on the UFC 213 card, Mearshart, also known as GM3 or The Machine, took on a heavily favored Thiago Santos of Brazil, and for the first time in his entire career, Mearshart was knocked out. Yeah, a big surprise. TKO in the second round for Santos. The loss snapped a four-fight winning streak for The Machine. Well, the big news in combat sports nationally has been centered around the Floyd Mayweather-Conor McGregor fight that's coming up. Here in Madison, though, we've been treated to some great action in MMA from the Chosen Few and in boxing from Supreme Hits. Well, Supreme Hits announced their next big card, and it will feature a whole lot of local boxers looking to make a name for themselves. The exciting card, called The Rise, will take place August 12th at Madison Turner's on South Stoughton Road. Local pugilists scheduled to fight are Brian Guzman, Kevin Garduño, Chris Ousley, and Danny Torres, with the always exciting Deontay Boumaier Wilson fighting in the main event. I'm sure we will have interviews with the fighters on upcoming shows. They've been in here before. They like it. Former Wisconsin Badger guard Bronson Koenig is off and running with the Milwaukee Bucks as the NBA Summer League tipped off in Las Vegas. Koenig signed a two-year, two-way contract, which will most likely see him play for the Wisconsin Herd this winter, with the Bucks being allowed to bring him up to the big club for up to 45 days. Now, how did Koenig's debut in the Summer League go, you ask? Well, he can only go up from there, as Bronson Koenig shot just 1 of 6 from the field, 0 for 5 from three-point land. Yeah, not a great debut. I'm sure it'll get better. And the team that Koenig and three other starting seniors just left will be starting their season away from home. Yes, far, far away. With only Ethan Happ as a confirmed starter, the Wisconsin Badgers basketball team will play 2 games in New Zealand and 3 in Australia from mid to late August. Head coach Greg Gard will have the opportunity to add significant minutes to Demetric Trice, Charlie Thomas, and Alex Ilikainen, while also checking out the likes of Aleem Ford, who's a redshirt freshman, and Kobe King, who is a true freshman. The season's schedule for the Badgers has yet to be released. Well, for more information on our headlines and all the 411, check out these fine, non-fake news websites. Stick around, we have more interviews than anyone else. That's coming up next, right here on the Sports News on Wisconsin's 57 Sports. All right, time now to go ahead and talk some fishing as we bring in Scott King from Sauk Prairie Bait and Tackle. And welcome back, Scott. And it's been some beautiful weather lately, a lot of chances to go out fishing, a lot of chances to hit your place up, especially if you're a veteran. It seems like a great place to go. You get a little bit of a discount, don't you?
Every day we give our active duty and veterans 10% off at Sauk Prairie Live Bait and Tackle. Veterans Day is just another day.
Yeah, there you go. Always good to give back to those guys. I'm a veteran too, and so absolutely love when people can do stuff like that for us. So let's talk about the actual fishing now. What's going on? Hey, if we're looking to catch some walleye, where's the best spot to catch them right now?
So Lake Wisconsin is one of the better places to catch some good-sized walleye and good eaters. One of the things you want to do is fish in 8 to 10 feet of water along weed edges. Another good strategy is to troll a lot of the stump fields in those areas. You just want to be careful and watch out for all the recreational boaters and swimmers.
You see quite a bit of that on Lake Wisconsin for sure. How about bass? If you're more into that and you want to catch some of those, where's a good spot?
Bass, again, Lake Wisconsin, one of the better known places, or one lesser known places, is the Wisconsin River below the Prairie du Sac Dam. Very good smallmouth territory, up along logs, rocky edges, rock bars, pretty much all the way down the Wisconsin River from Prairie du Sac Dam past Ferry Bluff and beyond that.
So now a good strategy for them. What are they biting on?
A lot of bass are biting on swim jigs and plastics.
Okay. My son has had some good luck lately catching panfish. Where are they at right now? Where's a good spot to get them?
Crystal Lake has always been a great place to go for panfish. There's a lot of shoreline fishing. And usually we'll use wax worms, red worms, night crawlers, or one of my favorites, the Bimbo Skunk Jig.
Cool. And I know a lot of people now like to go to your place because you guys do things a little bit different than the big box stores. What kind of separates you from going to a Walmart or something like that?
Well, one of the things that you'll get, I hope, is a good sense of humor. one of the things that everybody asks at a store, at a bait store, is where are they biting and where and how and on what? Well, we don't always know the answer. And we don't want to make you believe that we have the answer every time. So we throw in a sense of humor. So when a guy says, hey, where are they biting? I'll say, in the mouth.
There you go. Where else, right?
Right.
So great stuff. Hopefully people are going to get up and go fishing very soon. Great, great weather that we've been having lately to do it. So Scott, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
A special thank you to Conan Automotive in Stoughton for supporting local athletics.
Hey, look, another familiar face on today's program is Dirk Gessler is back with us. He is with CrossFit Recursive. And welcome back in, Dirk. We've been talking a lot of CrossFit here lately. Let's talk about the difference between the CrossFit Games and how that compares to what you do at Recursive.
Sure, sure. So the founder of CrossFit, Greg Glassman, has a saying he likes to push about. Basically, the needs of Olympic athletes and our grandparents differ in degree, not kind. So, you know, the things that people are doing in the Olympics, the things that people are doing in professional sports, they may do it to a level higher or more intense, but everybody still needs to be able to sit down and stand up. If they fall down on the ground, they still got to get up off the ground, right? So, you know, you see movements in the games, and we do a lot of those same movements in the gym. But maybe not at the weights they have, or we scale them back so that anybody, literally anybody, can do these movements.
Yeah, and I think that's what's important to hit on, is that anybody can do this. What right. does a typical class look like at Recursive?
So what we generally do is we bring everybody in, the coach will warm everybody up, get the blood flowing through the body, get the oxygen transport going, and then we'll work on a little bit of mobility, maybe 5 or 10 minutes, just to make sure the joints are healthy and in good shape. And from there, we'll move on and we'll learn some skills, we'll work on some strength work, and then we'll finish up the hour with a good workout, get you sweaty, get you out of breath.
Now, I think the other question that people have too is, do you only do CrossFit there?
No, not at all. We actually have a lot of different opportunities. CrossFit was kind of how we started, and then we've moved into, we do a lot of personal training now. For just the people that don't like the groups or want a little more one-on-one focus. We've also introduced a new program, RX, Recursive Express. They're half-hour classes, not CrossFit. Real easy to get in and learn. You learn everything you need to in the 2 minutes before the workout starts. And you just get through, get in, get out, get sweaty.
And that's always a good thing. I think some people too, they might have been out of being at a good fitness level for a number of years, and they wonder, you know, CrossFit, I don't know, I haven't done it before, is it difficult? So on a degree thing or something like that, some kind of scale, how difficult is it to do CrossFit?
You know, I like to talk about the fact that it's actually very simple. It's not easy, but it's simple. You know, we teach you all the movements, we make sure you do the movements well, we make sure you do the movements safely. And you will, you know, you'll get a good workout in. It will be a difficult workout. It will work you very hard, but it's not hard to do.
You know, some people start down the path, they hit a plateau. What do you think is the biggest hurdle to getting in shape?
Consistency, absolutely consistency. It's real easy to say, yeah, I have a gym membership, and maybe you go 1 or 2 times a week or once a week, but you know, if you're not going 3 or more times a week and consistently doing that workout, it's really hard to see results. It's really hard to keep pushing past those plateaus.
You got to be committed, absolutely. So, Dirk, thank you so much. Pleasure seeing you again, and thanks for being on the show.
Thank you.
A special thank you to Conan Automotive in Stoughton for supporting local athletics.
Day of Familiar Faces continues here on the Sports News. Jeremy Schlitz is back. He's the athletic director over at Madison Memorial High School. And Jeremy, welcome on in, and let's talk about the spring season 2017 spring sports for the Spartans. How did it go?
Yeah, thanks for having me back. Yeah, it wasn't that long ago. Spring sports just finished up. We had a great spring. A couple of highlights I think of. Our participation numbers in girls softball are up. We're able to offer three teams and really looking forward to how that'll kind of play out for us. But also had some great results. You know, qualified 18 people for the WIA track state tournament, which was really neat. Girls soccer team got to a shootout in the sectional final for a state berth. We had a tennis player, Colt Tegmeyer, finished second at the WIA state tournament. And our boys golf team qualified for the state meet. So busy spring, lots of highlights that I probably missed there too, but it was a great way to finish off the school year for us.
A lot of great results, and now these athletes turn to their summers. What does a summer look like for a high school athlete?
Well, summer might be busier than school in terms of the athletic component, especially for our multi-sport athletes, and we try to do the best we can to make sure we're balancing that for them and helping them, you know, get some time to relax and recharge, but also give them opportunities to develop. So, you know, we've got over 250 student athletes involved in our summer speed and strength program. Just a way for them to all together as Spartans get better, not necessarily sports specific. But then you look and with the contact, the way that it works out with the WIA and all of our sports, there's so many opportunities for our kids to get better at the school, and we want to provide them those opportunities. And our coaching staff's been great about whether it's open gyms or contact days or camps and clinics, giving them those opportunities.
You know, some of the things that have affected summertime sports has been the privatization of summertime sports and a lot of athletes involved with that. How has that affected you guys?
Yeah, you know, it's tough and it differs from sport to sport, but I think anytime you're paying somebody who's a for-profit institution and you're looking at interscholastic athletics, you gotta make sure you're wary of that, because obviously our high school programs have the best interest of our student athletes, but unfortunately sometimes you've got people that are out there trying to capitalize on it. So, you know, that's what we try to do is provide those opportunities that everybody can access. And you just gotta make sure you're really careful. I think there's good that comes from some of the opportunities out there, especially in a city like Madison, to challenge our student athletes in some of the private ways. But you really wanna make sure that that's the program that does the best for your kid.
So now as we look ahead to the next school year, and we got about 30 seconds to talk about this, what's new for you guys? What's on the horizon?
We had a really neat summer from the athletic director's standpoint. We were able to resurface the track over at Mansfield Stadium. We got some new tennis courts going in. Did some reseeding on the fields, really some neat maintenance projects that we're working on to kind of upgrade some of the stuff that we've got going on with our athletic facilities. And yeah, it's right around the corner. You know, August 1st is going to be here before you know it, and we do our sports kickoff on July 27th, and looking forward to having, we had almost 700 student athletes participate in fall sports last year.
Wow.
So looking to get back there and increase that as well.
Always lots to talk about. Unfortunately, we're out of time. Jeremy, thanks for joining us.
Thanks a lot.
A special thank you to Conan Automotive in Stoughton for supporting local athletics.
Familiar faces here now on the Sports News as we bring back in Bill and Jordan from Went Racing. We also bring in Tina, who's along as well, first timer here on the show. Welcome on in as we talk to Went Racing. And again, I'm just flabbergasted. Love the story of how you become a Make-A-Wish kid, Jordan, all the way to making it out on the racetrack. If you could, and I guess this is for all you guys, what has that journey been like? How did that start, and how did you get to where you are?
Jordan was a Make-A-Wish kid he was diagnosed as terminally ill with his kidneys for his kidney transplant. And so Jordan wanted to prove that no matter what you have in life, you can go out and live your dream. And so he was accepted in the Make-A-Wish program, got lawn care equipment, but also raced on the side, and decided to show and prove to everyone that no matter what you have in life, you can still live your dream and succeed at what you're doing.
Wow, and it seems like such a death-defying thing to do. I mean, racing in itself, I mean, there's so much inherent danger that goes with it, and you hear about some of the stories that come out of that, but to be able to cheat death, it seems like, I mean, just an absolutely amazing story. And it seems like you guys are really good at helping to give back. We talked a little bit about it the last time. What are some of the things that you guys do, including that Race to Read program?
We gave books to all the children, and they went to my school and asked for books to give to Boyd Head Start for Race to Weed, and everybody was happy for all the books they got.
it gives back to, you know, people who always can't do those kind of things and have the opportunities to do that thing. That's what this world should be more about, is helping and caring and sharing.
Absolutely, and paying it forward, absolutely love that. Let's talk about the racing itself. Where are you guys racing this summer? How has it gone so far? I heard you guys got rained out a little bit.
Yeah, we're supposed to race July 8th, and we got rained out in Sun Prairie. We're racing in Sun Prairie July 30th. And gonna go test the tracks up at Plymouth, Wisconsin on Saturdays when they have the races there.
And what are you guys racing at? What kind of cars you guys drive?
Well, it's a micro sprint car,
okay,
with wing. So it's got a 600cc Suzuki engine in it. It's very quick and very, looks like it's very fun for Jordan.
I bet. This is great stuff. Guys, we got about 10 seconds. If people want to follow you, how can they do that?
You can go on wentzmotorsports.com. You can just follow Jordan's updates and stuff like that. And his website, it's got my pass on there. It gives him his times and race schedule and stuff like that. And also merchandise. The clothes that we're wearing, you can purchase on there for a very reasonable price, and just a lot of fun. You know, it will show all the stuff with George's community work and stuff like that too.
Excellent stuff. Bill, Jordan, Tina, thank you so much for joining us here in the Sports News.
Thank you.
Brought to you by Conan Automotive, taking care of you by taking care of your family's car.
All right, give me a C because Cassie Gallagher is here. She is the head coach of Madison East Cheer. And Cassie, welcome on in, and let's talk about cheerleading in the summer and what you guys are working on and all that kind of stuff. In fact, you've made some changes to your program, haven't you?
Yes, we are doing some changes this season. We're splitting it up into two different squads this year. So the game team that just does the home games for the football and the basketball, and then the competitive portion of it, to where that the team just does competitive team.
So now what are the differences? Now game cheer is what a lot of people see. They're at the games, they see what the cheerleaders do, versus competitive cheer. What does that mean?
So the game cheerleading, it's just strictly like the sideline cheers, the jumps, and then the competitive cheer adds more of a competitive aspect of the flips or the tumbling, and also the lifts or stunts, as we call them.
So now when you compete, then you're competing against other schools, are there meets? Mm-hmm. How does that work?
Yep, there's local competitions, and then there's semifinals and finals. So just like football or any of the major sports, we compete, and then anybody in our division, we compete against them, and then we go to the finals if we qualify.
Very cool. I would think that would entail quite a bit, needing equipment, stuff like that. So you've got to do fundraising. How are the fundraisers going? What have you been working on?
We actually just had our first fundraiser yesterday as our kids clinic. That was a very good turnout. The kids were super excited about it. They had a blast. Some of the fundraisers that we have some car washes coming up the last two Saturdays of this month. And then we also have a fundraiser with Chipotle, and then also a Snap, and then a candy fundraiser within the school.
Wow, that'll definitely keep you busy. So
yes.
That's always good stuff. Speaking of busy, you guys are doing something different now, a new junior team. What's that all about?
Yeah, so I wanted kind of like a feeder program. So the kids that are interested in joining the squad, they kind of get a little taste of it before hitting high school. So we started a junior team. So the feeder program from third grade to eighth grade, they can kind of get a taste and start training at that younger age. And by the time they get to high school, they can jump right on in and know what to expect.
Yeah, so what are the things that they would learn going in, like say as a third grader, or you're 9 years old or something like that, going into cheer? What are some of the things they learn right away?
Well, the cheerleading aspect, they would learn everything that the competitive team does. Mm. And then just the coaching staff really likes to work with the kids to make sure that we can use the cheerleading to make them better just as like an overall human being. Teamwork is definitely a huge thing working together to accomplish a goal.
Sounds like great stuff. Cassie yeah. Gallagher, thanks for joining us here on the program.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. Go Purgolders.
You know, usually when we're talking to the Radicals, it's Tim DeBile who is here and kind of who I was expecting, but we do a little bit better. We get someone who's actually out on the field a little bit more right now, and that's Pat Schreiwise, who is joining us from the Madison Radicals. And Pat, thanks for being here. And if you could, talk about this game you guys had the past weekend against the Windchill. Back in first place, big win, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was huge for us. So it clinches a home playoff game for us coming up on August 12th, which is great. We need to close out the rest of the season still. Our defense played awesome last night, took us up 6-1 early in the game, and we just rode that lead out throughout the rest of the game.
Yeah, you mentioned the defense. The defense has been amazing. You guys set a record last week, gave up only 13 goals last week or in this past game. Why is the defense clicking in so much right now at this part of the season?
You know, we were a little bit off at the beginning of the season, and I think we all just recognized that and started putting in the work and just came out as a team and have started playing full games, which is really big.
So. Yeah, it was amazing to actually see that you guys had two losses. One was actually at home, which almost never happens over at Breece Stevens Field. You know, Breece Stevens is kind of a home field advantage for you guys, isn't it? You guys are drawing some good crowds.
Yeah. We had, I think, a little over 1,400 last night, which is great, and we've been cracking that 1,000 mark pretty consistently at our home games throughout the season, if the weather's nice.
Yeah, exactly.
That helps.
Yeah, but it's been really good support. You know, a lot of people have been asking me, hey, ask the guys about Marquise Mason, and Mason played with the Badgers on the football team. How has he been doing his first year of doing this? How has he made that transition? This is a different sport.
Yeah, it is, and he's doing really well. He's learning really fast. He's picking up the sport really well, and he brings a mentality to our team, which is really nice. You know, coming from those organized, that D1 sport, and bringing that mentality to us, and it's really awesome to have that. So
very cool, yeah. And hopefully that's going to translate even more for you guys going forward. Let's talk about the rest of the way. Home stretch coming up for you guys. Who are you guys facing off again? What are the big games that are left?
Well, we got Chicago coming up next weekend, I believe, and then later in the month we have Family Day on July 23rd against, I'm trying to remember who.
Is it Pittsburgh?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Pittsburgh's always a big game. I know you guys have a bit of a rivalry with them, so that's always cool. So you get the guaranteed playoff game, which I'm sure we'll be there covering that one, all that kind of good stuff. You guys can make it this year to Montreal. That's where the finals are going to be held. Talk about like what kind of incentive that is to make it to such a cool city.
Well, it's really awesome. We got to go to Toronto in 2014, I believe, and that was really cool. And we just want to go back and have that experience again as a team. And Montreal is a whole different city. They draw really big crowds there. Everybody's really into it. Justin Trudeau is into it. There's been pictures of him with Royale jerseys on Twitter, which is awesome. So we would love to be able to be there that weekend.
Excellent stuff. Hopefully you guys will make it. I'm sure you guys got a pretty good chance at that. Thanks for joining us, man. Good luck the rest of the way.
Thanks.
A special thank you to Conan Automotive in Stoughton for supporting local athletics.
Hey, a big thank you to all the guests that were able to make it on the program today. Thank you as well for you, of course, for tuning in, and to our sponsors, especially Rick and the boys over on Regent Street. Yeah, that's the red zone over there. And Conan Automotive in Stoughton, which has been keeping us on for a long time here. We do appreciate that. We'll see you next time on the Sports News right here on Wisconsin's 57 Sports.